everybody. Happy Wednesday and welcome to Collider TV Talk, TV Talk for TV fans. I'm your host, Sinéad DeVries, and this is our weekly show where we bring you the latest news from the world of television, plus talk about the week that was in TV. Joining us this afternoon is Josh Macuga.
Hey, guys. Welcome to Collider TV Talk. We are here on a Wednesday, as Sinéad just said. We celebrated the 4th of July on Monday. I spent the whole day yesterday traveling on airplanes and being, you know, basically heckled by airlines that I won't mention on this show. And I made it back to Los Angeles today to be here with you lovely people talking TV. We got a big show. We're talking the Warriors, we're talking Tom Felton on the Flash, we're talking Lionsgate and Starz big merger, all kinds of highs and lows. We're doing an early pilot review of The Night Of on HBO, which we all are excited to talk about. And we only have one Twitter question today, guys. It's a huge one. We've been yelling, arguing. Sinéad wore her glasses, especially for Wednesday. Sinéad, who else is here?
Yep, that's right, you guys. Just for you guys. Also here, and might I say, she looks very tan today. It's Sasha Perl-Raver.
You guys don't even know. This is me, like, all the way dark. I'm so proud of myself. I spent 6 days in Mexico, and now I've been powering through television. I had, like, a day and a half, and I was like, I gotta catch up on Unreal. I gotta watch The Night Of. I gotta see what happened on Preacher. So my eyes are crossed, but my heart is gold, and I'm ready to get into it.
Awesome. And also here is David Griffin.
I just realized that Josh Macuga, my, you know, co-host of 2 months now, and I've known him for, you know, I would say over 6 months now, he does not follow me on Twitter.
What? So rude. That is so rude.
Oh, not follow me on Twitter. So this needs to change to the hashtag follow David. Hashtag follow David Macuga.
Hold on. I'm going to do it right
now.
That
is so rude.
So we were really not connected. I thought we were close. I thought we were friends. I thought we were coworkers.
Does he follow apparently you on Instagram?
Not.
What about Instagram?
He doesn't do Instagram.
Actually, I started an account.
He has an Instagram.
I just started. I'm on Instagram now.
Oh, well, now I can start tagging on Instagram.
There's no excuse about Twitter, though.
And I didn't know. Look, I just followed.
Maybe he didn't recognize me because of
God, I feel terrible, man.
David, I've been following you for as long as I can remember.
Thank you.
I followed you on the first day that we ever sat down at this desk together because I was like, this is a man who I want to be connected with at all times across all social medias.
Thank you, Sasha.
You know what it is? It's that we both have beards, and I feel we're connected via beard. And now we're connected.
We don't need social media to connect us.
Media at this point. All right, let's get into it. Sinéad, what is first?
All right. Deadline reports that the Russo brothers, who most recently brought us maybe the most fun film of 2016, Captain America: Civil War, are developing The Warriors as a one-hour drama series with Paramount TV and Hulu. The exact shape of the show is unknown, and it's not clear if the Russos will helm the pilot, as they are currently knee-deep in Avengers: Infinity War. But they are collaborating with writer Frank Baldwin on adapting the 1979 cult classic for TV. Josh, how would you like to see the Warriors come out and play on TV?
Well, Sinéad, if we had rehearsed before the show, you could have done the come out and play, but we didn't do that, so, because that would have been a little creepy. That's from the movie.
I honestly have no idea what you're talking about.
Okay, do you know the part of bad boy, come out and play, that? No.
No.
That was a little P. Diddy for your mama. How about breast milk? You made my day. That's Dave Chappelle. No one? Oh, come on. You guys.
Sasha went on a weird Mexican bender down in Cabo.
Completely true.
Did you say breast milk? Yes. You made my day?
It's amazing. Dave Chappelle did a takeoff on making the band with Dylan. I spit hot fire. And he makes, as P. Diddy, he makes them go to get
We are 30 seconds into the show, guys, and Sasha's already gone off to a minute tangent about a P. Diddy Dave Chappelle sketch from 1996. All right, here's the thing. I'm super excited about the Warriors. I love the Warriors movie. I'm a huge fan of the movie itself. Like, you need to go back and watch it. I watched it probably when I was really young, maybe like 8 or 9. And then again, when I was like, you know, all the way through my youth and into my adulthood. It's a very underrated movie. Not that many people know about it. They came out with a video game a few years back. I think it was made by the same people that did Grand Theft Auto. It wasn't really well received, but it did invoke like a new energy into the franchise. They've been trying to remake this for a long time with many different people. The guys that did Ghost Rider 2 and... other people, but they've been trying to develop this, and I think because of the success of the Russo brothers recently with Captain America and everything that's going on with those guys, we are finally going to see a Warriors. And I, you know, when you watch that movie now, that movie has so much potential to be a TV show because there are so many gangs. It's across all of New York, from the Bronx to Brooklyn to Queens and Manhattan. And
Coney Island,
where they're from. You, it basically is you know, a graphic novel comic book in a film, and now you have hour-long television on Hulu, and you can explore all of these different things, and you can go vintage gangs, you can go, and honestly, in the Warriors, they're all like dressed in cool costumes, and they have face paint. It's a really weird and creepy movie that has an unbelievable ending, and it really is a well-done movie. There isn't a movie, I don't think, out there better suited for television than Warriors.
I am so shocked to hear you say this, because I love the Russo Brothers. Yeah. I loved Civil War. I am not anywhere near as sold on this as you are.
Why?
Here's why, because the thing, first of all, you said it's not very well known. I think that The Warriors is one of the most iconic movies of like the late 70s. Mm-hmm. Like not as like Saturday Night Fever, but we're talking like cult classics, because this didn't do that well when it was released, no. But it has become a major cult sensation. Mm-hmm. I think that what made it such a great movie, and it is a movie that I love, is that it's so self-contained. It's basically like one night and it's this journey across the boroughs and can they make it. If you stretch that out, where's the immediacy? Where's the urgency? Where's the like, and yes, the gangs are awesome, but there's also some major racial stereotyping that I do not think we could get into anymore. And there's some interesting stuff. Like I loved the Lizzies. I loved all of these little subcultures that were going on. I don't know that I want to see it done over like a huge arc. If they said to me, it's going to be 8 episodes and then the next season we're going to anthologize it and it's going to be something entirely different and it's going to be like the gangs of Detroit, then I'm super into it. But if it's like, okay, it's under the dome, it might be one season. Oh, wait, no, it's going to be 6 seasons. Oh, wait, no, you guys aren't interested. It's going to be 3 seasons. I need to know that they're going to keep this tight and concise, because that's why I think the movie is so good. And yeah.
Your ideas sound amazing.
I'm
saying that an idea like The Warriors, which is basically a race against, it's a video game, graphic novel, comic book, I get with you, over a 2-hour movie, but at points it does feel rushed. Like you could have done longer series with certain gangs, and New York is so big now. I mean, you could go all the way out to Long Island if you wanted to. It goes everywhere. Hell, you could get in New Jersey, Sea Caucus. Nobody even stops at the Sea Caucus station on the New Jersey transit line. I've been to Sea Caucus a billion times. Nobody gets on, nobody gets off. Why is it there? David, tell me what you think of The Warriors.
Well, I think if they follow suit with like Noah Hawley did for Fargo and don't need to necessarily rely on the source material so much, but make it your own, this could be something very special. But also, like, looking forward to seeing the Russo Brothers outside of the Marvel element. I feel like as good as Captain America Civil War is, as good as, you know, those movies are, like, they have very similar color palettes, they have similar looks, similar styles. Outside of, like, maybe Guardians of the Galaxy, they all kind of look the same, so I want to see them kind of unleashed and to be able to do what they can do outside of the Marvel Universe, because, I mean, those guys know how to do action. Like you said, making one of the most fun movies of the year, they know how to have fun. So what you're telling about this, I don't know much about Warriors.
From what you've told me, it's so good.
I'm very excited because the Russo Brothers are behind it, and because it's going to be on Hulu. I like The Path. I love 11/22/63, so I'm definitely down to watch this.
Hulu is really doing some great work lately. They really are. It's their original programming started off very slow at the inception of Hulu, and now is turning into like kind of a player.
Sasha, your fears, I think, are hopefully it won't come true, because it's on Hulu and they can kind of take chances, a little more chances than usual, so it won't be like ABC or CBS or something like that.
Are you fucking kidding me? You just threw blush in my eyeball. What's wrong with you?
I powdered his face.
Jimmy, a break. Fine. Holy Christ. All right, Sinead. I'm always shiny. We're sweating in here. All right, Sinead, what's next?
Last week, Lionsgate acquired Starz in a stock and cash deal for $4.4 billion, something the two media giants had been teasing for about a year. Starz brings to Lionsgate a collection of 17 Starz and Encore branded premium channels. It also owns the Anchor Bay Entertainment home video distribution banner, which has handled Weinstein Co. film releases, among other third-party content. Lionsgate's library of film and TV series will surely offer a boost to the schedules of the Starz and Encore channels beyond the flagship Starz network. Sasha, what do you see in the future of this deal?
So I think this is interesting, and obviously, like, it's created these weird bumps. Is your eye okay?
Oh yeah, it's fine. It gets powder in it all the time via a makeup brush. What the hell is wrong with you? I love you. I hope Mexico is great. If you end up stuck there, I'm not going to be too pissed right now.
Okay. Rude. So here's the thing. Lionsgate has like 16,000 titles that they can throw onto the Starz network. But when you think about looking for a premium channel, you do not think of Starz as being where you necessarily want to go for movies. You're going to go to Netflix. You're going to go to Redbox. You're going to go to HBO. Starz is not yet the destination that an HBO, a Showtime, or even a Cinemax is. And I think the thing that made them so great was their deal with Disney ran out, so they didn't have Disney titles, and they had to focus on original programming. And I think they have turned out some fantastic stuff. I mean, Outlander, Flesh and Bone. I loved The Girlfriend Experience. I know some other people on this panel felt like it got a little bit boring, but
I loved it, yeah.
I mean, they have done great, great shows.
Black Sails.
Spartacus.
Yeah. So
Magic City,
which was gone too soon.
Have anybody checked out Power yet? Power is good.
Oh, I hear that that's great.
I think Power makes Empire look weak.
Oh, yeah.
Power makes Empire look weak for sure. Power also it's really long. I'm like slogging through it. I didn't like it a couple weeks ago when we were talking about it. I just keep giving it episodes a chance. I really want to be a gangster rap club owner.
Oh, me too.
It looks really sexy. Like, I've always really wanted to be a drug dealer. If there wasn't like so much blowback on drug dealers and like they always get caught and they're always like in a lot of trouble, I think being a drug dealer
is less risky.
Awesome.
Well, wait for the electric.
Never give up on your dreams.
Yeah. Everybody comes to Hollywood, got a dream. What's your dream?
I've always wanted to be a drug dealer.
Well, wait, we could have always done it together.
It's going to be legal by November, so then there you go. You can do it then.
True.
Well, your snorting skills are on point from what obviously, you and Sasha show me every week. Yeah. You know,
so. I keep trying to bring in pixie sticks, and he's like, no, I won't do it because it's bad to snort sugar as opposed to cocaine.
Sorry.
But anyway, I think that they were the smartest when they were going after original content.
Okay.
Because when you call up, like, DirecTV or Time Warner, you're never like, hey man, let me get Starz. They're like, hey man, let me get HBO. And they're like, well, we'll give you Starz too. Starz right now is the cheapest of the premium services. Mm-hmm. It's $8.99 a month. But it's not something that people are seeking out. I think that they really need to focus on original. And the thing that's great about Lionsgate is they're the company responsible for like Mad Men and Orange is the New Black. So there is a possibility that this will become like this super hybrid, but I hope that they really stick to programming as opposed to film.
Can you imagine though if they, I mean, I don't know how the rights exactly work, but they do have, you know, Hunger Games.
Yeah.
They could bring their movie franchises to do like, you know, you could do like a little like Hunger Games miniseries, like just set in that world. Mm-hmm. You know, there's so many stories to tell in that world. That would be awesome to see that.
I agree. And I think, you know, Lionsgate has been taking a lot of chances in original programming for a long time. And I think this investment into Starz and in defense of Starz is, yes, their original content has been on point lately, but they've also really stepped up their game in their streaming service and their app. Because a lot of their, you know, like Girlfriend Experience, they released that thing on the app. They were like, here, go and check it out. They are doing things that a lot of the other pay cable channels aren't doing. And I think Lionsgate is one of like the few, and they're a big name studio now. They're one of the few people that really does garden talent. Starz before a lot of these new series was like two seasons done. We've talked about it before. Yep. Now they're getting into programming that is setting the bar. We're seeing
Outlander was renewed for two seasons.
Yes,
two more seasons.
Yeah. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And they're investing a huge sum of money in this, so they're obviously passionate about doing something here, and I'm looking forward to what they're doing. Not only that, but you know, they're doing Film HQ, they're doing Comic-Con HQ, they're the money behind that, so they're investing in a lot of these properties that people want to see, so they're hands in a lot of things, and I think they're doing it right.
Yeah. So the other thing that's really interesting about Lionsgate is, yes, Hunger Games, I think, would be really interesting because you got all the districts you can go into. But in all of their... Your poor eye. Yeah.
Well, I get sensitive eyeball.
In all of their catalog, what you have is unlike, let's say, well, or similar to The Warriors. You have really interesting genre films that could be turned into TV shows that aren't necessarily that well known. Because if you think about like the early years of Lionsgate, they were more along the lines of like a Blumhouse by way of Weinstein Company. So there could be some stuff that we're not even aware of in that 16,000 that they could farm out and make a really cool show.
Yeah.
Agreed. All right, Sinead, what's next?
It was reported by multiple outlets that Netflix has ordered 10 episodes of Lost in Space. The streaming service optioned the rights back in November to the series, which originally aired for 3 seasons and 83 episodes starting in 1965. This is a project a long time in the making. Variations of a reboot have been in development in different forms, including a telefilm at NBC that ended when original star Jonathan Ames died, a pilot at the WB directed by John Woo that never went to series, and who could forget the 1998 1998 film starring William Hurt, Matt LeBlanc, and Gary Oldman that was critically panned. All of that has led to this Netflix deal. So, David, is this Netflix's answer to CBS's Star Trek venture, or is this danger, David Griffin? I said David Griffin. Danger!
Danger, Will Robinson. Danger, danger, danger. Yeah. No, I don't know if it's the answer to Star Trek, but this is an answer, and I'm excited to see it. I don't know why that 1998 movie was panned. It was pretty, pretty good.
Really?
Matt LeBlanc in there, right?
That's friends. I love Matt LeBlanc.
Yeah, it's friends, yeah.
Did you also like the Will Ferrell Land of the Lost?
No, I didn't like that.
Okay,
yeah,
okay,
I didn't
okay.
Like that. Well, remember, I was the one who enjoyed Jupiter Ascending, you know, with your friend over
right.
here. Yeah, so, yeah.
Jupiter
yeah,
Ascending.
So I guess I like some of the bad movies. But, no, I'm excited for this, because it's fun. It's a family space adventure. It's Swiss Family Robinson in a spaceship.
Is this going to be one of your white escapism shows?
No, it's space escape. Space transcends race. White escapism is togetherness and divorce and Sex in the City. That's white escapism.
I
thought it was all in Silver Lake. I thought it was all supposed to be in Silver Lake.
I go to New York City and watch some girls and stuff. I'm okay with that.
Cool.
I'm looking forward to this. This could be a lot of fun. I know it seems silly because the 1998 movie was, you know, didn't do well critically, but I'm excited. I mean, it's a family adventure in space. I think it's going to be fun. I'm down with it. I'm in.
I'm so on the fence because I was never a fan of like the original series. I always thought it was hokey. I mean, it is the 60s television. It's like watching a stage play of like your buddy's one-man show. You know what I mean? Where he's like, back in my day, it was like the Family Guy thing. What I'm saying is that like you had to suspend belief and like be like, oh, they're on a sound stage and whatever. And it's like a tin can robot. And then the 1998 movie came out and it was just so... around. It was like a really bad Armageddon mixed with like an even worse Event Horizon splashed on top of an even worse out of space movie in there, right? Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like the
Galaxy
best.
Quest.
I didn't love it. Oh. And to do this again, like Lost in Space just seems so hokey to me. But
it's a family lost in space, and they got to work together to accomplish tasks. I mean, that's storytelling.
Wait,
that's storytelling.
So for three seasons and 83 episodes, they were lost in space?
Yeah. I mean, it's like Gilligan's Island. You're stuck in that island. Yeah.
See, I was thinking about that. Okay. Gilligan's Island is actually a show that I love, but if they tried to reboot it now, it would probably be like that show Wrecked that's going to be on TBS. Like, it just doesn't have the same cachet anymore, and I think what's going to make this work or not work is 100% going to be tone.
Yeah.
Is this going to be Fuller House? Is this going to be Wrecked? Is this going to be like a dark version of space where the robot maybe has ulterior motives? I think it really depends on the way that they go. But at this point, we've seen so many space odysseys. You got to really do it right.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's harder for television than for something like concise. Like, I would love if they made this more like Moon, Duncan Jones's film Moon, where it's like a little bit creepy, but also like very darkly comic. I think that would be fun.
Was the original series like hokey or was it
super hokey?
It was like the Brady Bunch in space.
Well, that's what the movie got away from. It tried to be a little too dark, I think. I don't think maybe that's where they need to go with this. I think they could keep it lighthearted, but if they go, I mean, they could do, there's a lot of things on like long-term space travel that can affect you, you know, some movies like, there's that movie, was it Pandorum? It wasn't that great of a movie, but like it studies effects of like long-term space travel that can do to your body and mind and mental. I mean, this is good stuff. Come on, people.
This is good stuff.
They should probably make it a musical and then it would probably work.
Oh my goodness.
That I'm into. Mm-hmm. Cosine.
All right. All right. Thanks.
Okay, we're going to get into superhero rundown, guys. This is the point in the show where we talk about all the things in comic book and superhero television. Before we get into it, want to do a special little thing here. This past week, a couple days ago, Noelle Neal died. She was the first female, she was the first Lois Lane on the Adventures of Superman. If you guys remember that movie starring Ben Affleck called Hollywoodland, it was kind of about the guy who played Superman and his death. But the show aired in 1953 through 1958. She worked for a long time in Hollywood before that series, and afterward did some parting roles in the 70s and the early 2000s. She kind of was a forebearer for all the Lois Lanes, whether it was Terry Hatcher or the 19 girls that played her in Smallville. Mm-hmm. So just thank you for all the work that you did. And for us fans of Superman and fans of Lois Lane, you were great. So, Noelle Neal, you will be missed. Sinead, what is first in Superhero Rundown?
Tom Felton, best known as playing Harry Potter's foil, Draco Malfoy, is joining The Flash as a series regular for season 3, which sees Barry Allen entering into the Flashpoint paradox. Felton will play Julian Dorn, a fellow CSI at the Central City Police Department who suspects there's more to Barry Allen than just his good guy reputation. David, would you like to see Felton in a pivotal role or just a nuisance for Barry?
I want to see Felton in everything. I really like Tom Felton. He's one of my favorite guys from the Harry Potter franchise.
Really?
As Draco Malfoy.
Yeah. Hell yeah. He was definitely one of the best parts.
Yeah.
I expect him to be whiny.
What?
I thought he was. I think he's an excellent actor.
Yeah, he is. I mean, he was in that movie Belle a year or two ago. You know, he was kind of a villain in that role too. So I mean, I think this is perfectly set up for him. He's going to be an instigator. He's going to get under Barry's skin. He's going to be the guy you're going to love to hate, but I think he's going to pull it off. I think he's going to be perfect for it because he's going to be those guys like you love Barry, you love the Barry, the Flash team. But this guy is going to be the guy in the background, just being annoying and just you want him gone. But you're going to love him. I think you're gonna like him.
Okay,
you're gonna like him, Macuga.
Listen, I'm a big Harry Potter fan, and I liked Draco Malfoy. I think the character. I think he's a great actor, but I found his character to be really whiny in the books and
absolutely.
In the show and in the movie. He's a really good actor. I think it's really cool that The Flash is going after bigger names mm-hmm. and bigger stars. And I think that they have an Arrow as well. I think, you know, they're starting to get some good casting in there as well. Is they're going after these bigger names, not so much as like, look, we can get big cast members, but as we can put these people in the universe and they can work because these shows actually do matter and we're actually doing really, really great television. Tom Felton coming over to the States, you know, I mean, he's a British guy. He's one of your mm-hmm. boys. You know, I thought I would see him in more stuff like
he's
one,
boy.
Yeah,
he's one of David's.
You guys, those are my boys.
Yeah.
Those are my boys.
David gets off the plane in the UK. There's like a parade.
Like,
the Union Jack flying in the air, all about David Griffin. So I honestly would love to see Felton, you know, like he's a CSI guy and he plays, you know, Joe, I don't know what you're doing. You know, this Barry Allen character. And then something happens, he becomes a metahuman and a villain. But
I hope he doesn't turn into a metahuman.
Okay.
I know his characters, but I hope they just kind of keep him grounded. You know, okay. I think it's kind of more interesting in that world where everybody's a metahuman if he's not one.
What if he becomes Iris's love interest? Zing.
Iris and Tom Felton.
Zing.
Wow.
See? He kind of looks like, what was the guy that, spoiler alert? Spoiler alert?
Oh,
give it three.
The guy's
two,
in Quantico right now.
Yeah, who? What? He died in the first season.
Yeah,
what was his
Eddie.
Name? Eddie.
Yeah, Eddie.
What
yeah.
if he's the new Eddie?
Oh my goodness.
Tom Felton, maybe he gets some abs or something in there. He's looking all hot for Iris.
Looking all
he comes out of the CSI shower and Iris is just in there. He's like, whoa, what's up?
We have the new Harry Potter
Julian
coming out.
Dorn.
Look at you. All you need is like abs and you're like, well, it is the CW. I will say, as somebody who does not watch Flash, I feel like they are doing such a good job with both Supergirl and Flash of mm-hmm. casting people that make me want to watch the show.
Yeah.
Tom Felton is, I think, a phenomenal actor. Mm-hmm. I think that he's going to be, the thing about him is he always seems to know more than he lets on. And that as a sort of an ancillary character to the main dude, I think is always fascinating. I would watch just for him.
He has great presence. Even as a kid, when you first see him in Sorcerer's Stone, and he comes up the stairs and his head will putter. He's like, looks at him, like, he's just so good. Even as a little kid, he was good.
Yeah, for sure.
Harry Potter.
You could be his sister. You guys have like a definite.
Do we both look evil? Do we both look evil?
Oh my God,
I could see that. Right? I could definitely see that.
In movies and TV, you would be a bad guy.
Oh my goodness, thank
for
you.
For sure.
Oh, that's
David
so nice.
And I would definitely be like the good guys. We'd be like, oh, I mean, McCook's and Griff over here.
I feel like we'd be detectives on the case together.
Oh,
and
really?
Sinead would be the girl that breaks all of our hearts. We'd be like, Sinead, you, and then she's got
Sinead's
a boyfriend
the
who's
the
a
love triangle between you and I.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Or Sinead's the one that gets killed and we spend the rest of the show trying to find out why mm-hmm. because we have to avenge her death because everybody loved her so much.
Correct.
Totally.
Correct. Like, if this is a high school show, you'd be like the evil girl that like runs the plastics. And Sinead, we'd like walk by Sinead, and Sinead would be like somewhere in the middle. She'd be like AV club, but also like really popular.
It's
and
glasses.
David and I would walk by her locker and be like, hey, Sinead. She'd be like, I don't know who these assholes are, but hey. Yeah.
But I think secretly, Macuga's actually the killer, but he just doesn't want any of us to know.
Yeah, exactly.
I'd watch it.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
While appearing at Heroes and Villains Fest in New Jersey, Stephen Amell announced that former WWE star Cody Rhodes, aka supervillain Goldust, will be a guest star in season 5 of the CW show. Arrow returns in October for a new season, which will bring, among others, DC Comics superheroes Vigilante and Wild Dog to the small screen for the first time in live action. Josh, does the addition of Cody Rhodes lead us towards this darker season 5 we've been hearing so much about?
Well, you know, Stephen Amell has this hard-on for WWE. Like, everything. He, like, fought at SummerSlam last year against Cody Rhodes. Mm-hmm. It was this thing. And now they're, like, bros. They're doing Instagram poses together. Probably lifting weights. Like, 22 Jump Street when Channing Tatum and the blonde
spot
guy.
Spot me, dude. Spot.
Just lifting so weights and, like, throwing weights around. And then they're going to get in the thing. And you know Rhodes is going to play a bad guy in the show. He's not going to play, like, somebody that can just walk in the Arrow cave like everybody did in season four. I think that, again, like, with Arrow, it's cool that they are trying to get more audiences to come in. And we know that that WWE audience is very loyal. They're very fervent. You say one bad thing about the WWE and they've kidnapped your mom and you're holding them for ransom. I mean, they are intense fans of their people. And the fact that Amell has, like, kind of transitioned a little bit in this WWE world and then bringing some of these WWE people into Arrow is kind of a cool little thing. It's like, you know, if you can act on the stage, and even if you are a weird looking character who's holding a star and he was gold, you are looking, it is kind of a cool thing. And I really think that I know I'm hyping this season of Arrow, but the last couple seasons we've gotten into, like, a weird place of, like, is it good or is it bad? Trending a lot towards bad. If they go back to some badassness, Cody Rhodes is a cool addition.
I don't think it's Cody Rhodes. It's just, Arrow's on the defensive right now. Flash cast Tom Felton. It's like, we have Tom Felton. This is great. We have Harry Potter on the show now. This is awesome. Arrow, everything they're doing right now is so defensive because most people didn't like last season. Yeah. So, like, hey, we're going to have, you know, this is our villain's going to be like a villain on The Wire. It's going to be like Idris Elba's character on The Wire. And then we're going to have the longest one-shot, you know, fight scene ever seen on cable. You know, it's like all this. And now we got Cody, we got Rhodes. I mean, they're just on the defensive so much. Yeah. I hope this goes well, but I just want to see a good story. Yeah. Tell me a good story. So I'm hoping this is good, though. I like
this
guy.
It's not a one-off. I'd like to see him be, like, part of a big
You know, some of the villains come in, they're a villain of the week, and some of them are very good, but some of them you just kind of forget about. I hope this guy's not one of those ones you
really
forget about.
I'm really tired of the villain of the week.
Has Cody Rhodes acted?
He took an acting class.
You seem so aware.
No, that was said in, like, the Stephen Amell interview.
He said that,
like,
with so much conviction.
He took an acting class.
That's more than most.
You know what? I have to say, speaking of WWE stars, did you guys see what John Cena put up for 4th of July about, like, the difference between patriotism
that commercially
and
did?
Just loving?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
my God.
Great, yeah.
I mean, I have wanted to, like, be all up in them guts for a while with John Cena, but now even more so, like, my love for him just grows and grows and grows. And speaking of love, Cody got very excited when you mentioned the other Cody. Was that... He's like, because his name's Cody. Was that why?
You hear Cody off screen, but he just went, his name's Cody. Everybody named Cody is apparently awesome.
So exciting. Yeah, exactly. But everybody named John Cena is super awesome. Yeah. And he is a really good actor. And I love him. And I want him to be on a show or in more movies because I think he's great and he's a good person.
Here's the problem with WWE stars. And it's obviously not a problem for The Rock, but it's some of them have the hard transfer because they are so big.
Oh, yeah.
And they are just massive human beings. And once you get to a point of being that muscular, it's really hard to lose weight to become, like, svelte again. Your body just doesn't have the thing because they do steroids. Listen, you can't get to that point. You can't get that big without doing steroids. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I think steroids should honestly be legal as long as they're done by a doctor and whatever. Totally against the point.
That's not going to get any comments.
HGH, it's a normal thing. Baseball players, it helps them recover. Either way, regardless.
And then home runs.
You can't get that big and then slim back down and be like a normal guy. So, like, if you wanted to cast John Cena in a rom-com, the thing that people keep saying is, like, he shows up at the place and the family like, Jesus, he's big. You know, like, that's
gonna
the
whole thing.
You're going
to be typecast for sure.
But he was so good, like, in Sisters. He was so funny. He was one of the best parts of that movie.
Well,
he was great in
Trainwreck. The way they used him in Trainwreck was great.
Yeah.
Like, a CrossFit guy.
Fantastic. Yeah. So that's the thing with a lot of these WWE guys. They can act. Mm-hmm. They can get into these roles, but they have to be, they will get typecast because you can't be that big.
Right.
Again, unless you are Rock and you transcend everything and somehow are cast in every movie ever and they just write parts for you.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, it's also his likability, which I think John Cena has a lot of.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. All right, we are going to go into our Preacher review. It's the part of the show. We'll talk about this week's episode of Preacher. We are without Game of Thrones now for the time being. So if you guys want to take a little time out for a second there. But we do have Preacher. And at this week's Preacher, the first 17 minutes was a video game.
It was crazy.
Imagine you are playing this. I was talking to my brother about it. I'm trying to sell my brother on Preacher. Okay. And I was like, it's kind of like a really creepy video game at points because when they were in that hotel room and people are, you can throw up spoiler alerts, I guess.
Alert.
We just throw up spoiler alerts. My bad. I mean, we didn't. We haven't spoiled anything just yet. Not that there really is anything to spoil in this episode, per se. And in this whole series, there really isn't anything to spoil unless you're like, well, the one guy's a vampire. Like, you know what I mean? It's
I feel like with all the crazy scenes that happen every week, even if you said, like, hey, there's a chainsaw battle in a church, you'd be like, okay. Like, it's just so much random things are happening that wouldn't really spoil it for you.
But we actually found out, like, some, like, what the power is this week. Right. So we did find out some stuff that could be kind of spoilery. But yeah, like, the motel sequence, the way it was shot.
Isn't that a great way to juxtapose everything? Like, they give you all this explanation. Okay, what, you know, what's inside of me? Yes. Okay, we know what's inside of him now. We know where it comes from. We know how it was made, you know, between an angel and a demon. And then all of a sudden, it cuts into this hotel scene where you have no idea what's like, wait, what is happening? What's going on? They just confuse you even more. Like, they give you an answer, and they throw you a curveball, which was very well done.
So imagine you're playing a video game, like those old walk-across video games, like Ninja Turtles or something, right? And your guy keeps getting beat, and then he hologram dies, and then another one appears. It's like,
it's up, they have the game. They have the game genie hooked up. They have infinite lives.
I know. Yeah. It's just
I like what he's like. I was like, how does it work? He's like, it just happens. That was the answer. It just happens.
No, but I love that. Like, don't kill, just subdue. Just subdue. That was genius.
And then when Cassidy walks in.
Oh, my God.
Boom.
And the casting of the woman in the mom jeans was incredible.
She was so small and, like, tiny. Like, just perfect for her.
I know. Yeah. Exactly. And I'm telling you, that scene in the hotel may be my favorite scene outside of Game of Thrones this year on television.
Wow.
Even better than some of the Peaky Blinders stuff this year. Yeah. Just awesome. And I think that what they did well is in that scene, but also in this episode of the show, is I think we see where we're going. The first couple episodes, I had no idea the direction of the show. Now I actually see, like, kind of a through line of where this is going to be taken. And a lot of times dogmatic stuff is done wrong on television or just, like, weirdly. But the fact that we're getting, like, these angels and these demons and these seraphims and they're being really honest about it is really, really super cool. I'm totally digging that.
I loved the first 10-15 minutes of the show, but then I have to say, this was one of the more disappointing episodes for me. Yeah, well, maybe it was because I watched 2 weeks back to back. So I felt like a little bit of lethargy.
Okay.
And I was actually getting really frustrated because I was like, you guys, come on. Like, more stuff has to start happening. Like, there's not enough narrative arc. Okay. I have fallen in love with these characters. Like, I love Ruth Negga. I think Tulip is the bomb. I love Cassidy. Dominic Cooper is fantastic. But there's just not enough going on. And quite honestly, I think the problem is when you gave me the comic, David, which I enjoyed so tremendously, it wasn't all in this one small town. It was sort of like this quest they were on. And I want to see more of them outside of this town. I will say, though, Arseface continues to be my favorite character of the whole thing. I think that actor is doing a phenomenal job with, like, this much of his face to actually work with. Yeah. I loved the scene in the tunnel when the fireworks were going off. I thought it was beautiful. But I need more.
But don't you like what happened at the end of this episode with...
Yeah, but I need more.
It was so sad, like, because you can see he wants to be accepted. He wants friends, but he knew it was all fake. He knew it was all manufactured, and he's like, I want you to take it back.
Do you think we'll ever see how Arseface went down and what happened with the girl?
Yeah, totally. Of course, we're going to have to.
Yeah. Okay. So give me your overall feelings of this episode and then give me some bazookas.
Bazookas? Yeah. It's out of 5, right?
Yeah.
I want to give this 4.5 out of 5 bazookas. Yeah. I absolutely love this episode, mostly because of that beginning and because of the end, and to see how Jesse, he's not just going bad all of a sudden. It's slowly, slowly, slowly kind of trickling down where he doesn't realize the significance of this power. Yes. Last week we saw, you know, he tried to convince the guy to, follow God, and we saw that he used a shotgun and killed a bunch of people. So, I mean, this power is not from God. It's an abomination, according to them. So I think that's really cool that he's slowly and slowly kind of falling into that, but he doesn't see it. Mm-hmm. He thinks he's doing the right thing. He thinks he's bringing people the word of God like he's supposed to be doing. He made a promise to his dad. So I think this is a great episode.
4.5 bazookas.
Yeah, 4.5 bazookas out of 5.
The guys, please, can you just?
So you talking about the angels?
Their names, the angels.
So the guy from Boardwalk Empire.
Yes.
Who? Is, Fiori.
Yeah, he's Anatole Youssef.
Okay.
And then Tom. Oh no, that guy's Tom Brooke.
Okay.
But Anatol Youssef is the guy who's in Boardwalk Empire. He played Lucky Luciano's right hand man.
What's the name of the characters?
Oh, sorry, name of the characters. Yeah, Flory is the tall guy, and then DeBlanc is the shorter guy.
I love him. Yeah. That dude is awesome. Yeah.
The casting of that
is so good.
Is the classic, like, good cop, bad cop, dumb cop, dumber cop.
Yeah.
And I love it. It reminds me of Jay and Neil in Inbetweeners. I know you watched.
Oh my God! Inbetweeners, interesting.
Right? Because Neil is like the tall idiot, and Jay is kind of an idiot, but you like trust him a little bit more.
Yeah.
And I love their dynamic together. I'm really looking forward to the fact that they meet Preacher and they basically say, we're not going to kill you to get this out because we kind of like you. You've charmed us over. But also that the Abomination is working on them. They're not immune to Jesse Custer's power, which right. was a really cool turn for me.
That was.
That worked. Because I thought they were going to be immune to it. Like, you know, the buzzing bee in Phantom Menace when he's like, the Jedi tricks don't work on me. Why? Because you're a buzzing bee? Give me a friggin' break, Jar Jar Binks' friend. Anyway, I'm going to give this 4.6 homemade bazookas out of 5.
Whoa.
Loved this episode.
Wow.
Those bodies piled up in that hotel room, that was like Commando on steroids.
Yeah, which is why I'm going to give it a 3.6 out of 5.
Really?
And three of those are for that first 15 minutes, first 10 minutes. Yeah, Sasha the rest of the episode really disappointed me, you guys, I'm being honest. I mean, I don't know if it was just because I was tired because I'd watched a lot of stuff or if it was because I had watched the night of going into this and my expectations were shifted. I was disappointed.
You tend to surprise me.
Thank you.
You like really trend towards surprising me mostly because it's like you're tan. Right? You think your tan is like...
I'm so tan right now.
You are really dark, but in fact, you are just as white as you were before you left for Mexico. Cody and Adam, can we get a concurrence? Thank you very much.
I have tan lines.
But you always have a fresh take on it, so we're just going to go with it. Speaking of fresh take, guys, we're going to do something we've never done on this show. Do you guys like that transition? Cody,
yes.
Put that in the old blooper reel. Guys, we're going to do an early pilot review of The Night Of on HBO. It is not airing until July 17th, but it is currently available online, on demand, on the HBO Go app. So you can go and watch it there. We're going to do spoiler heavy, so you can throw up the spoiler alert again. We've been up there for a second if you guys don't want to know what's going on Night Of. But really and truly, there isn't really much to spoil because the trailer kind of tells you what's going on, and the actual hour plus of television that you get is awesome. I knew within the first 5 minutes of the show, I was like, I'm hooked.
Oh my God.
I knew it's so well shot. It's so well written. It is so friggin' creepy.
It's
this show, I watched it twice because I wanted to see certain things, like certain things that the camera picks up is almost like a crime scene investigator, right? He sees certain things. I hate to like compare it to Willem Dafoe in Boondock Saints. But you know how Willem Dafoe like sees certain things and he's like, it was shot here and it was shot here.
Yeah.
If you walk through that thing and you have a very smart investigator, which I like the guy that they have playing the investigator. He's not the typical asshole cop
Fox.
But a lot. Yeah, that they usually put on TV like, yo, kid. You kill her. And he killed her. No, this guy's really smart. He's methodical. He knows what he's doing.
He's nice. He seems to be
really
nice. I'm
nice.
Like, this guy's a pretty nice detective.
Right.
But then when Totoro like hears his name, he's like, oh no.
Oh yeah.
He's like, not him.
Yeah.
And
Totoro's the only star in the show.
Yeah, but Riz Ahmed is going to be a star. He's going to be he's in Rogue One.
I'm so
coming
in
out
love
in
with
Star
him.
Wars Rogue One. Ugh. Riz Ahmed's going to be a star. And Nightcrawler, he was fantastic too.
So absolutely. Good Nightcrawler. Yeah. And I didn't know he was British. I had no idea he was British.
That makes him even better.
And I was like, oh my God, because having grown
hey,
up
Britain, we still
in,
love you.
We still love you.
You
yeah.
Guys.
But okay, so while I was getting exceedingly tan in Mexico, I was with our dear friend, Kara Warner, friend of the show.
Yeah.
And she was like, oh dude, I have all 7 episodes. You can watch all 7, but there are 8 episodes. So you're going to have to wait 2 months for the last episode.
Don't do that.
And I was thinking about it. I watched the first episode and I was like, I can't, I have to watch these as they're released because if I can see all 7 and then I cannot watch the 8th, my head will explode. This is like the best version of a fictionalized first season of the podcast Serial.
Yep, absolutely.
The acting is
it's
phenomenal.
Based on a British series.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Again, makes it even more and better. Yeah, just better and better.
This is
sometimes we get the British the adaptation right and sometimes we get it wrong. I think we got this one right. Thank you, HBO.
So I don't know how the next couple episodes are going to play out. I'm wondering, is this going to be a POV from other versions of the story and more details will be unfurled? I love that what you're talking about, like how they're making certain things apparent that they want us to notice. I do not know what is coming next. I love the whodunit aspect of it without it being like a... Like, True Detective wasn't good because of the whodunit. True Detective was good because of the atmosphere, because of the acting, because of Cary Fukunaga.
Yeah.
This is good because not only do you have great casting, beautiful visuals, like the way they shoot the stuff in the taxi, of just the lights of New York around you, the way you see his POV when he's sitting in the back of the squad car and you're feeling the tension mount, like you get so much agita watching the show. This is good because you have both the acting, the atmosphere, the direction, the writing, but the whodunit also, I am like yo,
yeah,
who done it? Yeah. Did this kid go off the rails? Is there some crazy like covert op going on? The dude who was driving the hearse, guy didn't seem like he was on the up and up. Is this going to be some weird racial thing? Her dad was a bad man. She couldn't be with her dad. What's up with her dad? There's so many options. Yep. Mm-hmm. And I am so beyond thrilled that I get to watch this. And I think we've talked about vinyl. I feel like this is what vinyl should have been. This could be HBO's next great series.
This could be the next True Detective. I'm that positive that how good this is.
Me too.
So again, thank you, England, for not only sending us a great project, but your actors as well. We are big fans of them. David, what did you think?
Well, a little history on this show is interesting too, is that James Gandolfini was originally supposed to be John Turturro in this role. So you'll see, when you watch it, you'll see executive producer. I think he pitched it either as a series or a movie first. HBO didn't go ahead with it. Then they brought it back. And then when it started going, that he died, unfortunately. So Turturro was fantastic, but I would have loved to have seen James Gandolfini in this role too. He would have killed. Both actors are great. They're both great and talented. Mm-hmm. So I love this. I'm into it. Like you said, everything you guys both said, I'm into it. I love the sports. We're going to talk a lot about sports here in a little bit. I love all the sports conversations about talking about Amari Stoudemire and Carmelo Anthony. I'm a New York Knicks fan. I grew up in Western New York. It's just cool to hear all that as well. It just feels very New York. It feels like New York. They're not. When you see some of these shows, they're shot in Vancouver or other places, Cleveland to represent New York. It doesn't feel like New York. This feels like New York, really, you know, sitting like by New the York. River, watch. I mean, it feels like New York.
With the GW Bridge, which I used to look out my window and see.
Yeah, my sister used to live near there.
Totally.
Yeah.
I want to apologize to any cab driver out there when I lived in New York, because there'd be sometimes when you're driving down the street and I'm like, turn off, goddamn, put it, say no service. I'm freaking out because I can't catch a cab. I was those frat douchebags that would get in the car and be like, what, dude? Just drive. Like, I was kind of that a-hole. So I want to apologize to that. Sinead, did you get a chance to watch Lionsgate? It's all right. We still love you.
It's so good. You're going to love it.
No, but it's really scary, right? So I can't watch it alone.
Oh, it's not scary. No. It's not. It's tense. It's very tense. Very tense.
No, it looks real scary, you
it
guys.
It is kind of scary.
It's not scary.
Too. Yeah, don't lie to me, because if I start watching it and then I can't sleep tonight, like, guess who the hell I'm going
to
bug?
You can come to my house.
The lady in my life watched it, and she was hooked immediately too, and she's watched it twice again. It is really, really well done. Okay, out of five hidden knives in the pocket, how many do you get?
Oh
my God.
Oh, 5 out of 5.
Yeah, I'm going 5 out of 5.
5 out of 5. Yeah. 5.5 out of 5. It gets like a 4.2 GPA.
I'm so bummed that they released this like 3 weeks before the pilot comes out.
Me too.
I'm like, I just keep rewatching the pilot. If it's on, I'm just like, I have nothing else to watch. Even though I have so much to watch, I keep watching it.
Oh, we should
say,
this could be like True Detective, because you just do Night Of. Because I think Night Of in the UK has gone on to do more seasons. You can just do a different series. Yeah.
No, this is so good. I mean, if I had access to all 8, I would watch all 8 right now. Like, I would see you guys on
Friday. I'm sure we can go down to Beverly Hills, go into the HBO offices, knock on the door. I'm sure they'll be like, oh, of course.
Hey, guys.
TV Talk Crew's here? Oh, of course.
Well, we have 7. Can we just have the 8th, please?
Damn it, you guys. Okay, well, then I'm going to watch it today, because you guys just sold the crap out of it. But then I'm going to group text all of you, okay? As per usual.
Watch it during daylight.
Don't be scared. There's peacocks all around your house to keep you safe.
That doesn't make me feel any better.
Okay, that was our pilot review for the Night Of. Thank you guys. Again, check it out. Let us know what you think. Hashtag at Collider TV Talk. Leave us a comment in the comment section below. We love reading them. Let's go into some highs and lows. Sinead, what's first?
Amazon's All or Nothing and Netflix's Last Chance You.
David texted me to watch Amazon's All or Nothing. I binged all 6 episodes immediately. Triple thumbs up. So high. I'm so high. The trailer.
6 or 8?
Or 8. Sorry.
Okay, good. My bad.
I binged them like just so many in a row that I forgot like what episode I was on and just went through.
Well, I saw your photos on Instagram. Like, you know, Josh is in Pittsburgh right now with his family and his lady. He's having a good time. Yeah. He's throwing beer cans into garbage cans off his front porch. I guess that's something. See, that's the my white escape is. There must be stuff that people do like this. That's awesome. So I said, he's got to watch this, though. He's got to watch this.
Oh,
and I was so happy you told me that you liked it.
Hi. The trailer for Netflix's Last Chance You. I read a lot about this project. There was an article in Sports Illustrated a little while back about it. I'm so high on this. It is a tiny little cut of subculture of what football can help or hinder the human being.
Even if you don't like football, it's worth watching. Even if you're not, like, so for instance, I know we have a lot of people from the you know, Europe and other parts of the world that watch this show, and because I'm a Chelsea fan, I like, you know, European football, and people like to talk to me about that. But even if you're not an American football fan, it's worth checking. It's just a very well done documentary. You have John Hamm doing the narration. It's the entire season, unlike HBO's Hard Knocks, it just went up to the preseason and stopped. This is worth watching. It's very well done.
So my only concern, I think both of these, I texted both my husband and my best friend, and I was like, we're putting this on the list, especially Last Chance You, which is basically about about like a community college that people who want to go into football can go to try to like get a second chance. That to me reminded me of an amazing documentary called Undefeated, won the Oscar in 2011, I think. I cannot wait for that. Like that I'm all about when it's on Netflix. My issue with All or Nothing, which I will watch and is on Amazon, is it's done by NFL Films.
Yeah.
So it felt a little propaganda-y to me based on the trailer. And I was like, well, is this just
watch
like...
it.
Okay. Because I just feel like it's a little difficult to have an unbiased product if you're doing something on, you know, like if I did the TV Talk documentary, I wouldn't be like, here, this is how you guys look like fuck-ups. I would only show how you guys look great.
The... HBO obviously does Hard Knocks incredibly well. I think Showtime has kind of dropped the ball in some of their sports documentaries, especially that All Access for the Stanley Cup, which I thought was going to be amazing. And my Penguins won the whole thing, so I got to watch all this Penguin stuff, and it just wasn't that great. Amazon knocked it out of the park with All or Nothing. And it takes place over last season, so you already know what happens, and it's still just as dramatic. Mm-hmm. Go and check those out, both highs. Okay, Sinead, what's next?
Roberto Escobar, which is Pablo's brother, wants to review Narcos season 2.
You know what? I think this is really funny, so I'm giving this a high because he's like, I'm not going to tell them that I don't like that the series is wrong and to go reshoot. He's like, I just want to watch it first. And he's like, yeah. Cool, dude. Go ahead.
See, I thought he wanted to sign off on it before it aired. He just wants to see it first. Dude, I want to do that too. Yeah. Hi. Good job,
dude.
Yeah,
I'm thumbs up. I'd do the same thing if I had that kind of power.
He's like, that's my brother's story.
That's crazy to me, but I mean, I think it's awesome. Like, kudos to him.
Yeah, when Sinead's documentary Shenasty comes out, you know Kelly DeFreeze is going to want to be like,
hell yeah,
let me see it first.
Yeah.
What's next, Sinead?
All right. Kevin Smith will be directing episode 7 of season 3 of The Flash, and he's also discussing how onomatopoeia would work on Arrow.
I'm going to give, like, again, we've talked about this. I'm going to give the medium thumb on Kevin Smith directing. I mean, great. He loves comic books. It's awesome. But I would love to see him get into Arrow and get his villain that he's been so passionate about on Arrow. It sounds kind of cool. His onomatopoeia doesn't really talk. He just, like, in the way he described it in this this interview on comicbook.com, about how he would incorporate it with, like, giving people note cards and be like, bam, and then he shoots them or something like that. So he's like a really creepy, dark villain. So I'm going to give him a high on that one, a medium thumb on Flash.
Well, we know that he's good at doing something with no dialogue because Silent Bob, but the rest of those words meant nothing to me, so I don't care. Ha-ha.
Yeah, high on the character. I don't care much if he directs an episode or not because, like we've talked about this before, the style and way that Flash is shot is not going to change no matter who really directs it.
Nothing. Sinead, what's next?
Everyone wants to know if David's watching Marco Polo season 2.
Yeah, the fans need to know. I am watching Marco Polo season 2. I actually wrote a review of it already, and I'm going to, I'm on episode 9. I'm only one more away from finishing it. It's excellent. No one's talking about the
show.
Should
we watch Marco Polo?
Marco Polo is the second most expensive scripted drama on $90 million per season.
What?
$90 million
per
season.
Marco
Game of Thrones is $100 million this season. $90 million Marco Polo. No one's talking about it.
Wait, what? Where is Marco Polo? Netflix.
Marco Polo is Netflix. It's a story about, you know, the Italian Marco Polo.
It's about a really heated game at your local
place. It's crazy. Yeah. And people are just like, Polo.
Yeah. But he goes to Kublai Khan's, which is Genghis Khan's grandsons.
That's his pool.
Yeah. And goes to his kingdom and kind of is adopted into the family and works his way up, and now he's a trusted advisor, and it's really interesting. It's worth checking out. I mean, it's a beautifully shot show. It's not perfect. If you look on, like, Rotten Tomatoes, I think it's like in the 20 percentile.
What?
And critics do not like it.
Critics hate it. Critics I cannot.
I'm a critic, but I actually really enjoy
that.
It. I don't think it's a perfect show. I put it up there with Vikings.
Okay.
Yeah, it's
20%.
Like
20%.
So out of five Kublai Khan tree
five
clubs.
Kublai Khans. I would give this season, I'm on the penultimate episode, I would give it 3.8.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Somebody actually tweeted me asking if David was watching.
I like how they know it's just
I'm
me.
Dead
There's
serious.
One, we have one fan or a couple fans that are really passionate about Marco Polo. Yeah. So we
and we've also
about
got
it.
A fan who really wants us to watch Person of Interest. Bro, love you.
Hey, that
Not
fan, whoever to give a shout out to the fan, whoever made that little meme of... Like, was it
you
for
watching
Heroes,
Vinyl?
Collider
yes.
Heroes?
That was fantastic.
That was so good.
No, I retweeted that. That
somebody
was beautiful.
Did somebody say
Vinyl? Yeah.
Yeah. Like, no, that was great. I tried Person of Interest. I could not get past, like, episode 4, and I will never. Sorry.
It's
sorry.
Little,
my apologies.
Okay, Sinead, what's next?
All right, well, let's talk about The Bachelorette cop-out.
All right, here I go.
You got to give the rose. You can't just be like, I like them both. That's not how the show works. You get rid of the tall ginger.
Josh.
Go ahead, Sinead. Go ahead.
I personally think that was a nice thing that she did because she didn't want to send one of them home because she likes them both. I don't think that she can make that decision and be like, oh, you know what? I have to give away this rose because that's what the rules of the game are. At the end of the day, this is a relationship. So if she likes them both enough to keep them, then keep them. You know what that means? We get one extra week of The Bachelorette, and I'm not arguing with of that.
That's not true, though.
Of
that's
the
not
two,
true.
Which they one will would cut you take?
Them. No, let me say, I have not watched the episode because my husband's watching it and I'm not, but he'll probably drag me into some part of it. That's not what'll happen. They won't get an extra week. They're going to cut two people. They'll cut an extra person in the following week. And P.S., I guarantee you, I love that you guys are getting passionate about it, but the producers were probably like, this episode sucks. We have to do something to make this one
I don't think
memorable.
The episode sucked. I honestly
I don't think
she's
it did
still,
either.
I think she likes them both, and that is a good thing for me.
By the way, if you are a guy out there watching The Bachelorette and you're single, don't be like Wells or whatever Wells. That guy is. Kiss the girl. Yeah. What does Sebastian say in Little Mermaid? You gotta kiss the girl.
Yeah.
Okay. Sinead, what's next?
Freeform Orders, Lonely Island, produced pilot, Alone Together.
All right, I know the writers and Starz, I know them both well. They're both stand-up comedians, Benji Aflalo and Esther Pavitsky, very funny people. But I know that Lonely Island doesn't have the greatest track record of producing pilots. They've had so many pilots that haven't gone anywhere. I hope this is different. This sounds really like complainy Silver Lake kind of show, so David Griffin
God,
will probably
David.
Love it.
Yeah, I'm looking forward
Yay.
To this. Yeah.
In hopes that my friends do really well. Thumbs up on high in hopes that it's not another Lonely Island pilot. Mm-hmm. This could be a low.
I can say quite honestly, I've never watched a show on Freeform or ABC Family. I do not think that this is the one that's going to make me do it. It sounds like a younger version of Love, a show that I absolutely hated because it was just too effing whiny.
Yeah.
But D. Griff, go ahead, gush. It's okay.
Go ahead, gush. I'm looking forward to this. I haven't checked out the new revamped ABC Family.
Do it.
Known as Freeform. I have seen the first season of Pretty Little Liars.
Yeah, no.
It's in its entirety.
Freeform's got a bunch of new shows out. They have the one that's from the producers of Lost premiered last week. And they have this whole, like, they're trying to do more edgier content. And some of it's actually pretty good.
Yeah, we'll check it out. Yeah. All right, let's speed it up a little bit. Go ahead, Sinead.
CW and Netflix agree to air all previous seasons of the network's shows.
Hi. Oh, my God. To this I say, Gossip Girl marathon at my house, you guys.
Come down.
But I've had some friends talk about who are cable cutters who have Hulu that are going to miss it because they could just get up the next morning and watch it on Hulu in the morning. Now they have to wait for it to go to Netflix. It's not going to be on Hulu anymore.
Oh.
So for Hulu people have cut the cord who aren't going to cable, thumbs down.
Oh, I did not know that.
Shanasty, what's next?
Yeah.
All right, Comcast is going to allow their customers to stream Netflix on its X1 box.
This is what we've been talking about for since we started this show. All these cable providers are now getting their own streaming boxes. Uh-huh. It's going to be like the Comcast Roku or the DVR thing.
I'm pretty sure this was your idea. Like 7 weeks ago.
Should have gone on Shark Tank.
Hi, the Josh Macuga box. Hi.
I'd buy that one for sure. I mean, this is the wave of the future, you guys. Pretty soon, TVs and cable boxes won't even be a thing. Remember rabbit ears? R.I.P.
Yeah, it's fine. I mean, I have a smart TV, so I already have those apps. So thumbs down. I don't need it, but.
Well, okay.
Sinead, what's next?
Chris Evans has exited Top Gear.
Yeah, this guy, first of all, just keep Matt LeBlanc as the host. I watch Top Gear. It's great, but that dude's a doucher. And he's in sexual assault. He's like, he sexually assaulted somebody. Of course he's gone. Get rid of that dude. Don't put him on TV again. Give us people that don't sexually assault people roles on television. Next.
Whoa, don't watch it. Didn't hear about that. But Jesus, down. Sexual assault, thumbs down.
I'm not familiar with this case, but if that is the case, thumbs down.
Sinead?
I had never heard of that before in my life until right now. Anyways, Rob Lowe added to Code Black. Now, does this mean that they cure all the patients?
Code Black, they always cure them by the end, or they lose them. We're not sure.
I've never watched the show.
Rob Lowe.
I like Luis Guzman, and I love Rob Lowe.
Yeah.
So, but Rob, it's CBS.
Lowe?
Rob Lowe? Rob Lowe? Rob Lowe.
Rob Lowe, I'm in. I like Rob Lowe. I love Rob Lowe. He was great in Parks and Rec.
All right,
thumbs
what's
up, Rob Lowe.
Greatest hits on ABC. Did it work, guys?
They put Pitbull with REO Speedwagon. Quit messing with my cassette deck. Lowe.
Wow. I didn't watch it. I do like Arsenio Hall, but I'm terrified now. And it seems like a terrible
Pitbull
concept.
And REO Speedwagon.
No, I know,
he's
but
hosting. Oh, right,
Arsenio
right,
Hall
right.
is hosting. Is
REO Speedwagon the one that does Making Love Out of Nothing at All?
Run, baby. If that's all you want. Never mind.
You guys, wow. This is what happens. We go on vacation and
if
Macuga's unhappy, then I'm unhappy.
Correct.
Thumbs down.
There you stand. Nasty.
Right. Another ABC. The canceling of Uncle Buck.
That's a high. Come on.
Did that even premiere yet?
Yeah. They had
Here's the thing. We're talking about the Warriors. Uncle Buck is getting canceled. Shooter looks terrible. Frequency looks terrible.
Lethal Weapon.
Lethal Weapon looks terrible. Yeah. Maybe we shouldn't make movies into TV
shows. No, it's just under the head. No, I know ABC had a little bit of a leadership transition, so this, I'm assuming, is still the old stuff coming out.
I think
out.
That the reason this got canceled is because the ratings were so low. Okay. And it wasn't, like, critically acclaimed either.
Right. And it wasn't even about the movie. Yeah. Sinead.
Cruel Intentions over at NBC is still in the works, and the network is working on renewing the cast option deals.
Yeah, again, this is another movie thing. Why are we redoing Cruel Intentions? Right. Just do, like, a high school show. Basically, like, younger Gossip Girl. Make it cool, hot, whatever. Don't call it Cruel Intentions.
Younger Gossip Girl, that would be junior high. Gross.
Whatever.
Stop being weird.
I don't know.
Stop being creepy.
Okay, sorry. Low.
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 All right, Sinead, last one.
Okay, so this is 30 seconds of PLL with Sinead. So do you want, like, everything that's happened this season? It's only 3 episodes.
Yeah, go.
Okay, but we got to put a spoiler alert because I know the fans don't want to be spoiled.
In 3, 2, 1, 30 seconds, go.
Okay, so the 7th season starts out with the entire group of people seeing somebody that looks a hell of a lot like Allison's mother, who we all know is dead. She died at the end of a couple seasons ago. So we know she's dead, but we see her walking to the police station. So they go after her. They find out that it's actually her missing twin sister, Mary Drake. So Mary Drake is new at Rosewood, even though she is technically Allison's mom. She's the new villain, along with Dr. Rollins, which is Allison's husband. He turns out to be evil. The girls find out, and last night he actually dies when they hit him with the car. So now we don't know what the hell is going to happen next.
30 seconds of Pretty Little Lies with Sinead DeVries. The best around. All right, guys. We're going into Twitter questions. Hashtag at Collider TV. Talk, send it all week. I have like a long document of questions. You guys send in some amazing ones. So if you haven't asked it yet, we will get to it. This, I promise you, like that 98 Degrees song once said. Was that who sang it? This, I promise you.
That's NSYNC, whatever.
Whatever. My bad, I know. I'm really showing some stripes this weekend here, guys.
I'm really proud of you for not knowing it, and prouder of myself for not knowing
myself for knowing it.
All right. Okay. We have one Twitter question this week because this is a big one.
It's Sinead. A thinker, you guys. It's a thinker. All right. Jason Smith tweets, what's your top 5 shows of all time? Mine are Game of Thrones, Spartacus, Sons of Anarchy, Fringe, and Deadwood.
Wow. I hate this question because it's so hard.
I mean, I can start. I already have mine.
Go ahead.
Wow.
Okay, so... Now, I'm not necessarily saying that this is the best television. I'm basing this question off of
your
rewatchability. Okay. Like rewatchability. Oh, shows that I can watch all the time.
Smart. Good.
So not necessarily the best, so don't judge. Okay. Friends, obvi. Mm-hmm. Family Guy.
Ooh.
Yeah.
One Tree Hill.
Okay.
Gossip Girl.
Okay.
Yes. And Pretty Little Liars.
Okay, obviously.
I feel like we know so much about you.
Yeah.
You guys probably could have guessed that entire list.
Yeah.
But Netflix there, party.
It's your opinion, and it's rewatchability. And for me, the rewatchability of Family Guy is nonstop. Like, I can watch any episode of Family Guy anytime it's on. Mm-hmm. It's always funny. There's always a good cutaway. Great list, Sinead.
Thank you.
Well said.
Thank you.
I was never a One Tree Hill guy.
Neither was I.
So I don't know much about it.
And
I never watched Gossip Girl, except I know that, you know, like...
Gossip Girl is
it's the best.
Fantastic.
It's the best. Like, there are still Mondays where I'm like... Fart. I can't watch Gossip Girl.
It's really good.
Okay. It's so good.
That's where I developed my crush for Blake Lively. I watched the first couple seasons. I saw The Shallows this past weekend, too.
What's up?
It's good.
I love when she zips up that wetsuit and it's just like titties.
She is absolutely gorgeous.
Cody, put that in the blooper reel. You got it.
Sorry.
I will say, Blake, I got my first crush on Blake Lively in a little film called Sisterhood of the
Traveling Pants. Was it number one or number two?
The first one.
She's playing soccer, hair's flying in the wind.
I think that's actually before she had her nose job, too.
Yeah, well, good nose job, you. No nose job, I'm in.
You're in.
David Griffin, give us a top 5.
This is so hard. This is so much pressure.
It's all British shows.
This isn't, yeah. Oh, no, I forgot my British shows.
Oh, no. Oh, new man.
New list. Got to redo. Give me fun. No. So this is in no particular order. We need to do like a, have like this big like 2-hour show. We need to do like top 20.
Yeah,
this
sure.
is way too many shows. Okay, so
maybe we'll do a little
no particular order. Battlestar Galactica.
Okay.
My favorite shows of all time on sci-fi. Sci-fi. Sopranos. Mm-hmm. HBO, of course. The late and great James Gandolfini. May he rest in peace. The Wire.
Going back-to-back HBO shows. After that, now this is a combination because I'm doing part of a show mixed with a miniseries. So here we go. I have seasons 4 through 8 of The Simpsons. They are money. Yeah. If you watch seasons 4 through 8, every single episode is good. So seasons good. 4 through 8.
I'm with you on that one.
And I'm going to combine that with Band of Brothers. It's a mini series, but it's still a television series. Band of Brothers on HBO, great World War II
story. Doesn't matter if it's 6 episodes or 10 or 400.
It's television. That's television.
It's still television.
And then number 5, a little show called Farscape, which was a show mostly comprised of New Zealand and Australian actors, aired on Sci-Fi, but Ben Browder, an American, was on. There's about an American astronaut gets launched and goes in space, malfunction, goes through a wormhole, and he's with all these aliens, and he doesn't know what's going on, but he's still American. He's still who he is. So like, there's all these great film references. It was aired from 99 to 2002.
What's the character's name?
You mean the...
Or the actor. What was the actor?
Ben Browder.
Wow. Danger, Ben Browder, danger.
it was really good. So that's one of my favorite shows. It's a tough list. Okay. There's other shows that could easily go on this top five, but those are the top five that I'm feeling
right
now.
It's David Griffin's list. This that's is my all list. A subjective
I love how we're all
thing.
Like apologizing.
No,
it's
because
so
you
hard.
Can hate. Like,
it's
I can't believe you forgot this
question.
Show. Again, there are a lot of shows out there that we just, you know, there's so many. We could do top 50, top 100. Maybe we'll do, guys, thank you for the question, by the way, Jason. We're probably going to do like a special video of like the Collider TV Talk top 50 or even like a top 100 that we break up into 2 episodes.
I think we should do it by decade because like I had 5 from my childhood and then I did 5 from like regular life, but it's so difficult. Like we should do like the 80s, the 90s, 2000s, now.
Yeah.
And that should be the breakdown because it's so hard.
It is. Okay, Sasha, why don't you go? I'll go last.
This is really hard. Okay, so I said Game of Thrones, mm-hmm. obvi. Mm-hmm. Lost, so good. Sex and the City.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Now here's where it gets so hard. I need you guys to vote. Do I go In Living Color or Chappelle's Show?
Hope we don't play that.
Hope we don't play that. Okay, fine. It's In Living Color.
Yeah.
Oh,
as
MacGruber
said,
so
MacGruber don't play like Homie and Homie don't play.
Homie don't play. Okay, so it's In Living Color. Although, man, I was watching the Rock of Hat sketch of Chappelle's Show the other day.
This is your second Chappelle
reference. Oh, my God. Because it... Breast milk. You guys have to rewatch that.
I never was a Sex and the City girl. I don't get that.
Well, you're younger than I am.
It may be just a little bit ahead of your time.
Yeah.
Like before your time, not ahead, before.
Okay.
It's too far.
So I had to throw one in from childhood. So it's Game of Thrones, Lost, Sex and the City, In Living Color. And now here's the question. These are the shows that like really formed me as a kid. Should it be, this is hard, because Cosby Show's on here, but I feel like it can't be because of what's happened.
It's tough. Cosby Show was great.
Mork and Mindy, which was like the best. Mm-hmm. Gem, which totally like gave me everything with like my personal style.
Yeah, I'd love that.
Or The Muppet Show. I mean, The Muppet Show is so...
Muppet Show or Muppet Babies?
Muppet Show.
Muppet Babies.
No, it's Muppet Show. What do I do?
That's so difficult. I don't even know what to tell you.
Yeah. I would, well, just for like the classic nature of it, I would go Morgan Mindy.
Really? Oh, God, Robin Williams, who totally reminds me of my dad. Okay, good. So I'm going Game of Thrones, Lost, Sex and the City, In Living Color, and Morgan Mindy. Thanks for your help, guys.
Good work.
Cool list.
Okay. I had a little tie at 5th place. I had a three-way tie. Mad Men, Peaky Blinders, Sons of Anarchy.
Oh,
that's a tie?
That's a tie.
Say it again.
Mad Men, Peaky Blinders, Sons of Anarchy.
I vote Sons of Anarchy.
Me too, because that's the only one I've seen.
Oh, Mad Men.
Mad Men. Okay. I was leaning towards Mad Men because I think it really gets me excited is my grandfather like lived in that time, and it reminds me, like kind of gets me a little nostalgic about like what my grandfather might have been like in the workplace.
Oh, cool.
Hopefully he wasn't as like
creepy. Yeah,
misogynistic. Sure. You know what I mean?
You know what's kind of funny about that? Not to be crazy, but like my grandfather actually worked in the elevator of an office building. My mom's dad in Ohio. So I think my grandfather, if he was in the show, he would have been helping Don, you know, go down, up and down to the elevator.
But he could have been like a pivotal character.
He could have been.
Because my grandfather heard a lot of things. My great-grandfather was a barber in the city of Pittsburgh for a long time, and he got rich because he listened to the rich people talk in his barbershop, and he invested in what they talked about.
So
basically
smart.
Illegal, but he listened
and he went and did it.
Damn,
that's
genius. Kind
of
cool.
But if we're talking sex scenes, Sons of Anarchy wins every time. I still have the GIF of Charlie Hunnam humping on my phone.
The back hump. Montage.
Back up montage.
Yeah. FX loves showing butts.
It does.
Okay. Like showing butts.
So I'm going to go Mad Men, but ooh, Peaky and Sons. Anyway, they're in there. 4 Game of Thrones, 3 Sopranos, 2 Breaking Bad, 1 Seinfeld. That's my list.
Yeah. I love that you I, like You even put it in order. Like, I couldn't possibly order those.
And I could rewatch any of those episodes. I mean, obviously, like, The Walking Dead is around there, like, seasons two, one and three.
One and two.
Yeah. But, you know, there are certain shows that I wanted to put in there. There's so many. Again, if you guys want us to do, like, a top 100, we can talk to Dennis about maybe, like, breaking that up into certain things or whatever. But that was our top five. So you guys know there's a little summer present here from the Clatter TV Talk team. Guys, we'll go into Pick of the Week. That is my pick of the week. I'm picking my own. I'm going to go 30 Rock.
Yay!
I went and it's been on TV a lot, and you can stream it on Hulu, and you can find it pretty much everywhere. 30 Rock turned Tina Fey into an overnight movie star. Because the show was so smart and so genius. Everybody was like, oh, I remember her from Saturday Night Live, and she was really great on Saturday Night Live, and she was a writer, and she had done some like smaller movies, but 30 Rock took her to like another level. She was on the cover of Time and People and all these, like every publication, and you fell in love with the lovable loser. But there was also like a weird sex appeal to Tina Fey, to Liz Lemon. And the fact that it was so cleverly written and she had her hand in every part of it, and it really delved into like the inner workings of a sketch show, but it really had nothing to do with a sketch show. And Alec Baldwin, again, that show turned him back into a star. And Jane Krasinski, or Krakowski. Jane Krakowski. She was a name and we knew who she was, but then saved Tracy Morgan's career. Tina Fey should be given Emmys just posthumously every year at the Emmys for saving so many careers of people that should still be in Hollywood and still be acting because they are super talented and started careers of many people based solely on the show. Was it ever the ratings juggernaut that like a Game of Thrones or a Blacklist or whatever people are watching, a Shonda Rhimes show? No, but it was so critically acclaimed that NBC kept it on the air because it was so smart that if they canceled it, they themselves would look stupid. 30 Rock, go watch it. An unbelievable comedy. I know there's a lot of British people out there that ask sometimes what American shows should you watch. 30 Rock, check it out.
Hell yeah.
Hell
love.
Yes.
I love that you wanted to squeeze the lemon. That makes me so happy.
Come on, I love a little lemon, even with the bra that, anyway, so many good episodes. All right, that's it. That's our episode of Clatter TV Talk. Guys, thanks for tuning in on a Wednesday. I know with, you know, the holiday time, you guys are like, where was the show? It's here on Wednesday. We'll be back on Monday next week with the same crew talking weird stuff. We're going to have a great, great time. As always, Sinead, where can the good people find you?
I'm online at Sinead DeFries and at thatsosinead.com. On Mondays here hosting TV Talk, on Fridays hosting Movie Talk, and hosting Collider Mailbag over the weekends.
David Griffin, back with a vengeance with the beard, looking strong.
You can find me a few places. You can find me on Instagram now, at GriffinDE. Also on Twitter, at GriffinDE. Just trying to make it easy for you. Make it all in
sync. I'm following you.
Yeah, finally. It took him long enough. And also on here, of course, every Monday with this lovely crew.
Always great to have you here, man.
We've done a few shows now. Insight. It's been a couple of months, I know.
We've been
doing
a pretty good job. Thank you guys for watching. Sinead, or Sasha.
Same thing. Wow. I wish
see,
I could
see, look,
Sinead.
Even after all this time, gets you guys mixed up.
But at least he followed me on Twitter a while ago. But if you want to follow me on Twitter, it's at Sasha Perl-Raver. Also Instagram, where you can see my incredibly tan butt. I'm super tan.
Oh, I
you
saw
guys.
That was a great picture.
Hello, thank you very much, because I'm tan, and tans cover up all matter of sin.
Uh-huh. I saw that picture and I was like, maybe that means that I can post a picture of myself in a thong bathing suit.
You guys, let's all follow me and follow her and get her to post a photo. That's the mission
hashtag
for the week, guys.
Sinead in a thong. Let's
hashtag
see how many retweets we can get.
Shenasty butt. Hashtag shenasty butt. Also Thursdays with the Schmoes and Fridays hosting FX Movie Download on FX at 8 p.m.
Awesome. And you guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Josh Macuga. You guys can see us here every Monday. Hashtag at Collider TV Talk. We love you guys so much. Every Saturday on Film HQ on the Comic-Con HQ app and my YouTube channel, The Josh Macuga Show. We love you guys. As always, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.